Everyone be still and know. Separate from our good, from our God. It is in the stillness and the quietness that we make the all-important contact with the presence of God. How good and how wonderful it is to know that this presence is never separate from us. So we never have to scream to get it to hear us. This presence expresses itself as us, so we never have to ask it for anything, because it knows what we need even before we open our mouths. This presence is within us and expresses itself as us. And so we never have to fear or wonder whether it will respond to us. And it's so wonderful to know that there is a place that I can go and be still and know that I am God. I've been running to and fro to this thing and the other, to this person and the other, seeking what we already have. But you see, it was only necessary that you be still and know that that which you have seeking has been seeking you. That which you desire, you already have. And all is truly well. Let's try it. Be still and know. Attention to the Epistle to the Romans. Paul's letter to the church and Rome. Paul is seeking to explain to the people how sin came into being, how sin is erased, and how sin actually has no power. So, we use this particular scriptural passage as a witness to the word of God, which we preach, beginning at the 15th verse of the 5th chapter. But the free gift is not like the trespass. If the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift in the grace of one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin, for the judgment following one's trespass brought condemnation. But the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If, because of one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's trespass led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience the many will be made righteous. The law came in with the result that the trespass multiplied, but where sin increased, grace abounded all the more. So that just as sin exercised dominion in death, so grace might also exercise dominion through justification, leading to eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. So it is written in the New Revised Version of the Holy Scripture. So it is.
To be a follower of Christ.
Today we continue our lesson theme from a different point of view, and our lesson sermon this morning is entitled, There's Nothing Original About Sin. There is a question that has been continually asked down through the ages. It's a pertinent question, and it is this. If we are made in the image and likeness of God, why do we continue to suffer? Is that right? Yeah. The suffering has become so predictable in life that in philosophy they have labeled it the human predicament. It is thought to be just a part of life, just a part of the human experience, to encounter great fluctuations in our lives, to have more or just as much pain as we do have pleasure, to go from mountain high to valley low, and all of that simply to lay down one day and die. Hallelujah. Just lay down there and die and are no more. But for over 3,000 years, it's a long time, the scriptures have sought to answer that question of why, if we are made in the image and likeness of God, do we continually suffer? But it answers that question in the form of an allegory. That allegory is called the fall of man. The fall of man is a myth, but its purpose is to explain the origin of sin, which is the cause of limitation and suffering. In the story, there is a man called Adam, and a woman called Eve. This first family, in the truest sense of the word, was placed in a fertile garden called Eden that was filled with fruit-bearing trees. They were instructed by their creator that they may eat of all of the trees except one. This forbidden fruit grew from a tree called the knowledge of good and evil. One day, the woman Eve was approached by a serpent who used crafty means to entice Eve to disobey the command and eat the fruit. Eve, in turn, convinced her husband Adam to join her in her little sinful escapade. But after the act, the couple realized for the first time that they were naked, and they covered themselves with fig leaves. Later on, in the cool of the evening, God don't like bright sunshine. In the cool of the evening, the Lord God came walking among the trees and called for Adam. This is the question that comes from the Lord God always to man. Where are you? And the man Adam answered the call by replying that he had heard the Lord and was afraid to come out because he was naked. The Lord then questioned Mr. Adam, and he said to them, Adam, have you been eating something that you ain't supposed to be eating? And Adam replied quickly this way, Eve gave it to me. Then the Lord God looked at Eve, and he posed a question to her. What is this, Eve, that you have done? She replied to the Lord God, "The serpent tricked me." And so I think began the beginning of trickle-down theories. Whether in economics, morals, or any other area of human endeavor. Once it had been discovered that Adam and Eve had sinned or broken the command of God, there was a punishment levied upon them by God. To the serpent who tricked Eve, he said, "You will be a cursed creature, crawling on your belly, and all women will be your enemy." To the woman, Eve, he said, "You will have increased pain in your childbearing, and your husband shall rule over you." Notice she had to sin for that day. Sometimes I can't help myself. She said to man, "By the sweat of your brow, you're going to work and live. And I'm going to even, to make it even rougher on you, I'm going to cause the thistles and the weeds to come up." It was then and only then that the Lord God made for them coats of skin. Coats of skin. But after he gave them the coats of skin, he kicked them both out of the beautiful garden, placed the protection around the tree of life so that they could not eat from it. That, my friends, is the literal biblical account of how the perfect and whole man that God created came to know limitation and weakness and became the human that we know so well. It is because of this original sin that every man and every woman that has come on this earth has come to know bondage and limitation. But the sin did not occur many, many years ago. The sin occurs day by day. Amen. You see, many people believe that a sin has to be a type of behavior. And they don't understand this, but Paul did when he wrote this way, "Every sin that a man doeth, he doeth it to the body." Meaning that your consequences of everything that you do is expressed in your life, world, and affairs. We have gotten so far off the beam from understanding ourselves as being made in the image and likeness of God until David the psalmist wrote this way, "Indeed, I was born guilty." Now this is rough, ain't it? "A sinner when my mother conceived me." It would be simple this morning to place the blame of sin on Adam and Eve. After all, they placed the blame on each other. But the truth is that sin and all of its consequences is never original. Quite the contrary, for from the beginning, it has borne the marks of a counterfeit existence in opposition to that which is truly real. Did you get that? I'm gonna say it again. There is no originality in sin. From the beginning, sin has borne the mark of a counterfeit. What's counterfeit? Not false. Yes, a false existence in opposition to that which is real. You got it?
Yes.
Preachers and parents like to talk about sin. For they use it as a means to evoke fear in the hearts of the listener. Mothers will warn their children. It's a sin to leave food on your plate uneaten. And there are folks in China, Africa, depending on which part of the world she wants to promote that day, starving. Preachers warn their parishioners that their sins will drop to the torment of eternal damnation. Both of them are using scare tactics to try and make people do what they think they want them to do. But if from a different point of view this morning, let's look at the story that I recited to you literally. From a different point of view this morning, let's look at sin in a way that will not put us all on a futile guilt trip. Sin. Sin, literally, the word sin is a term borrowed from the sport of archery.
Yes.
All right?
Yes.
Like archery, life has a target. The target is not on the peripheral edges of life. Instead, the target is to aim and hit the mark, which is commonly called the bullseye. The bullseye is the point of conscious wholeness and perfection. It is when we miss the bullseye that we have sinned. You got it? Because we are a generation of list makers and statisticians, we like to identify various types of behavior and place them under categories. And we have a category called sins.
Yes.
I want you to follow me today.
Uh-huh.
So anything that we don't understand, anything that's different from us, anything that offends our sensibilities, we place in the category of sin. But you see, I keep telling you that sin never begins with the behavior. Here's the other part of that. Nor is it ever corrected by punishment.
All right.
Okay. Hear me today. The archer, remember we said sin came from the sport of archery?
Right.
The archer will not shoot a more accurate arrow if you break his arm. Huh? In fact, if you break his arm, he may never shoot again. He will only improve his skill if he stops concentrating on the misses and begins to focus more steadily on the bullseye. You and I will not live in a more complete manner by nursing guilt of what we've done in the past, but by turning away from the sin and focusing on the perfection. In the biblical allegory that I recited to you a few moments ago, there are some definite insights into truth. But you cannot find them until you cease to view the scriptural explanation as an accounting of actual events. People, snakes don't talk. They don't talk now. branches, leaves, tree that has good and evil coming off of it. There is no such specimen in any horticultural book that you may read. His glue. Last Sunday we said that the Bible is my story. And that's for each individual, isn't that right? The Bible is my story. Now, see, we forget things from Sunday to Sunday. But think of me as a soap opera. And each new episode comes, but try to see if you can remember what happened last week. The Bible is my story. The Bible is your story. If that is true, then the characters called Adam and Eve are simply symbolic representations of parts of your nature and my nature. Huh? Instead of trying to visualize a guy called Adam and a girl called Eve, accept, if you will, this morning, that you have two sides to your nature. That you have a thinking or objective side called Adam, and that you have a feeling or subjective side called Eve. I'm about to say something, and I got men on my board now, they'll protect me. Get ready, fellas, because I'm about to blow it. Yeah. Adam and Eve were married. Well, they were joined together by God. Adam, here it goes. Come here, George, give me. Adam and Eve's marriage was the only one that God ever performed. I'm thinking bad, I'll say it again. Feeling and thinking.
That's right.
Well, the only union that God sanctified.
Yes.
This is the meaning of the scripture that said, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder.
Yes.
Not your little paper things. In my church today. It is impossible to divorce thinking from feeling. What it should say is, this is the marriage that cannot be put asunder, because it is only when the two have come together as one that you can exist as a whole and balanced being. Within each of us, see, we start to think, I'm a whole woman. Well, then you are a flake. Within every woman, there is male.
Amen.
And within every male,
yes,
there is female.
Yes.
And if you don't balance them,
yeah,
you are off balance. I want balance in my life. That means to say they want to party more. That ain't what balance is about. Balance is about finding
the right level so that both this objective and the subjective parts of your life come together for the wholeness and benefit of your ongoing. You got to have both of them to make it.
Oh, I ain't finished yet.
Now God takes Adam and Eve and he places them in a garden to tend it. Right? And we're not talking about an orchard or a tropical paradise. Is that right? This Eden, the garden in which God places Adam and Eve, symbolizes a pleasant, harmonious, productive state of consciousness. You got to get this real good. Are you listening? Which, in which are all possibilities of growth. I'm going to say that again. This Eden in which God places Adam and Eve is symbolic of the pleasant, harmonious, and productive state of consciousness in which are all the possibilities of growth. Now, I want you to hold on especially to that last part because this is important. Because this state of consciousness contains all possibility, it must contain the possibility of not being in harmony. This possibility of not being in harmony is the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Are you here this morning? Now, Adam was given freedom. Freedom is the absence of restraint. Is that right? Included in this freedom is the power to choose to live in a state of bondage or freedom. In other words, there would be no freedom unless you could reject freedom.
Wow.
Is that right? Think about it a minute. If freedom is the absence of restraint, then there could be no freedom unless you could choose not to be free. That is exactly what has happened to humankind. We have chosen not to be free. We have chosen to eat of the possibility of not being in harmony when it's become a part of our very existence, and therefore we have got out of sync with the rhythm of the universe and we find ourselves in what is called the human predicament. Is that right? Now, the Lord God, Lord means law. The basis of the law of creation, God, creator, the Lord God, tells Adam, Adam, you're free. But now everything you choose has a consequence. You're free, good buddy. Yo, I mean like, choose anything you want. But all of your choices have consequences. Now, hey, boy, let me tell you. If you choose to eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you are asking for it. But you do it. He put it to it this way. When you do that, you shall surely die. What did it mean? you will lose all consciousness of who and what you are. You will cease to remember that you had a spiritual origin purpose, because you began to delve into duality. Is that right? Now watch this now. Adam, you see, when God told him to choose, Eve had not yet been brought forth. Adam was placed in the garden. God gave him the command about the garden. Then he put Adam into a deep sleep, and it ain't recorded where he woke up yet. But while homeboy was asleep, he brought forth another side of his nature.
All right now.
Hey? Okay?
Yes.
It was always there.
Yes.
But he made it so he wouldn't be lonely. You see, the problem with us is when we see some other body with us, that's the only time we think we ain't lonely. When anybody that's with you is simply a reflection of what's in you. So you ain't with you all the time anyway.
Yes.
That's another sermon. But here he is now in this garden, and here is this other side of him that he is made aware of, his Eve or his feeling. Now, this part of our nature, our feeling nature, is highly sensitive. Highly sensitive. It is the creative part of our nature. It is creative part of our nature, but it is highly sensitive, and it is therefore vulnerable to enticement. Huh? So it is to Eve. If you read the scripture in Genesis 3:1, it is to Eve that the serpent comes and presents his case. Because you see, the feeling nature or the subjective nature cannot put up an argument.
All right.
It is passive.
Yes.
Whatever is given to it,
yes,
it must accept.
Yes.
So the serpent did not go to Adam. He did not, in other words, the serpent does not try to tempt the intellect. For the intellect has discriminatory faculties. Do you understand?
Yes.
But the female or Eve or the feeling nature has none. Watch it. There is no argument, if you read that passage, that the serpent gives. It, he simply comes and states his case. The serpent, lest you go back to thinking of old snake, the serpent is sense consciousness.
Yes.
Now I want you to write this down, because you have to work with this one. Sense consciousness, in which vibration, color, and sound exists. Do you hear me? Now, this is why when you work in the spiritual realm, you must go beyond the thoughts and feelings to the point of silence. At the point of silence, that mythical point of consciousness where you come to know your oneness with God, there is no noise. There is no vibration. Many people mistake emotionalism for spirit, but it is in the quietness and the calmness that the work is already done. Not in the noise. Anything that's noisy, the energy is spent.
Yes.
Has no more.
Yes.
But I move. We sang it this morning. Be still and know that I am God. Do you understand this?
Yes.
Let me I won't get off. The feeling nature, or Eve, is attracted by suggestions such as the sense nature presents, for it always carries with it the promise of pleasure. Every sin has behind it the promise of pleasure or enhancement. Otherwise, it wouldn't be tempting. Think about it. If it said to you, I'm coming so I can blow you away, you'd say, no way. Is that right? But every time you are tempted to indulge, it is always because it promises something that you think that you don't have at that present time. It's gonna make me feel good. Is that right? If the serpent or sense consciousness is subtle, it is crafty, it enters the soul for the purpose of stirring doubt. God told Adam, Adam, do not eat of this tree. Adam impressed it upon Eve. She knew the command. Watch this now. Here comes the serpent. Why? God simply doesn't want you to have a good time. That's the whole basis of it. He doesn't want you to do this because the day that you do this, I tell you what's going to happen. Your eyes are going to come open and you are going to see it all and you're going to be just like him. The problem is, you are already just like him. Sin is a failure to apply spiritual principles. For the serpent always comes and says, why not? I mean, what's holding you back? Why don't you go ahead and do it? Is that right? That's the serpent. Now watch this book. Once he gets Eve hooked, which is the feeling, she entices Adam. Honey, come here. She must entice Adam because Adam provides the justifiable arguments for indulgence. She ain't got an argument in herself. She just know, I just felt like doing it. I felt it. Something I couldn't do anything about. That's all she can say. Do you understand what I'm talking about? Anybody in church today? What? The serpent says, now here it is part, the serpent says that the route of experience helps one to see clearly. You understand? Experience. The serpent or sense consciousness is constantly trying to tell you that experience is your greatest teacher. Experience is your hardest teacher. You never learn anything from experience. Oh, yes, I did, Mary. I learned it from experience. No, you didn't. What you did was learned from the experience after you had reflected upon what had happened. It is the reflection that became your teacher. Now, if the reflection was your teacher, why in God's name do you insist on going through the experience when you can stop and reflect before it and save yourself some pain? Jesus talked later of the primary factor of regeneration when he said that when the eye is single, then and only then can the body be full of light. That singleness of purpose is not based on experience, but on reliance on the inner voice that speaks within the soul of every person. The voice of experience says that it is in experiencing pain that you can appreciate health. It promises that you can fare well by being independent of God, which is impossible. It promises much, delivers little. It has an unquenchable appetite that is never satisfied. That's why people are always going for the bigger, the better, the longer.
Whatever
it is. There is never a point of satisfaction with experience. But it is a point of satisfaction with spiritually knowing and letting that attunement be expressed in you right now. You can know that you are complete without adding anything else into your life. You can know that you are whole without anybody giving you anything. You can know that you are God's perfect child right now, right here, today. Let me get this because I want to... Look at this. I told you this. Whenever we listen to the other voice and indulge in a belief of good and evil, we have sinned. You understand? Anytime you believe that there is something other than God, you have sinned. Anytime you believe that you are anything other than God, you have sinned. There is no God and. There is no me and. There is only God. And there is nothing else. Watch now. We create a sense of separation from God. And what follows is behavior that corresponds to that mindset.
Yes.
You only start doing the stuff after you done thought the stuff.
Yes.
Thank you.